Welcome back to my channel. Today I'll be discussing the process of fertilization in human beings. Now, the question that has been asked by the late Professor Brian Sykes was, do we need men for fertilization to happen in human beings? Now, the late professor was a human geneticist and a leader in this field and a chair at the Oxford University. So he wrote a book in 2003, one of his best-selling books, known as The Adam's Curse, where he discusses the possibility of the SRY gene shifting from the Y chromosome to the X chromosome and effectively rendering the Y chromosome useless in terms of human fertilization. Now, you can read the book for yourself and see if you concur with him that within 5,000 generations, the male species will become extinct. But for now, fertilization in human beings still remains as the fusion of the sperm and the ovum to form the zygote. And this occurs within the ampulla or the fallopian tube most of the time. So the key steps with terms of formation of the zygote will start with the capacitation of the sperm. So talk about sperm capacitation. What you're talking about is the removal of the glycoprotein coat from the head of the spermatozoa. And this effectively allows the spermatozoa to be able to find the ovum because the receptors are basically revealed. And so once the sperms are able to find the ovum, the next step is these millions of sperms will be able to release the acrosomal enzymes to disperse this layer of cells known as the corona radiata. That dispersal is known as the acrosome reaction, and it forms the basis why we talk about infertility happening when you have a sperm count less than 20 million. So this number, 20 million sperms in an ejaculate, is important because those millions of sperms releasing their acrosomal enzymes is what allows this corona radiata to be dispersed and allows for one lucky sperm to be able to go through. And so once this penetration of the coats of the oocyte occurs, the next step that happens is the Zona reaction. Now remember, the Zona pellucida protects the oocyte, and so it thickens through what we call cortical granulation, and that prevents entry of more than one sperm. And so once you have this Zona reaction occurring, then you prevent polysperming, which will lead to a triploid state. So the next step now will be completion of the second meiotic division. And so these polar bodies, the second polar body is formed after fertilization, when the second meiotic division occurs. And so once that occurs, you have the formation of the pro-nuclei, so the female and the male pro-nuclei, which fuse and form the zygote. So formation of this zygote is the first result of fertilization, and so is the completion of the second meiotic division, which allows for the formation of the second polar body. Now, once this occurs, remember the spermatozoa and the ovum are haploid in number. And so once they fuse, you restore the diploid state. And if the spermatozoa that has gone in is carrying the Y chromosome, then you get an XY genotype. If it's an X chromosome, then you get an XX genotype. And so that process is important in terms of sex determination. Because of the crossover during meiosis, you usually have genetic variability. And so this allows the betterment of the offspring. And so genetic variability prevents the passing on of genetic diseases, basically things that can be able to be preserved within family lines. And so when you get this variability, you are able to improve the next generation. And so once the zygote is formed, immediately it starts to divide. And this is because of metabolic activation and restoration for the capacity for cell division, what we call cleavage. Now this is a normal human karyotype. What you have here are the first 22 chromosomes, what we call the autosomes. Then the sex chromosomes are in the 23rd pair, and so it can either be XX, that is female, or XY, that is male. Then you can have disorders of these chromosomes based on the way the fertilization occurs. Now, what you notice here is that the 21st chromosome has actually three chromosomes instead of two, and that is called trisomy 21, commonly known as Down syndrome. Then, if you look at this, you are able to pick another deviation. Okay, you're able to see that you have two X chromosomes, but you still have an Y chromosome. So this is actually a trisomy of the 23rd chromosome. Okay, and we call that Klinefelter's syndrome. Okay, what we call 47XXY. So ideally, remember, you should only have two X chromosomes, then an absent Y, or one X and one Y. But you cannot have two X and then a Y. That is abnormal. And so we call that Klinefelter's syndrome. You can have one where there is just one chromosome in the 23rd pair, what we call monosomy of the 23rd chromosome. And this is famously known as Turner's syndrome, where you just have one X chromosome without its pair, and there's nothing in the Y chromosome. So we call that 45XO, or Turner's syndrome. Now you can have one where you have three X chromosomes and zero Y chromosome. Okay, this is the super female, or the triple X syndrome, or 47XXX. You can have one where the 18th chromosome is actually trisomic. This is known as Edwards syndrome, or trisomy 18. You can have one where the 13th chromosome is actually trisomic. This is known as Patau syndrome, or trisomy 13. Now, you can have a condition where the spermatozoa that is penetrating the ovum is actually duplicated, or the Zona reaction was not complete enough, and so you had more than one sperm going into the ovum. So when that happens, you actually have a triploid state, where you have two spermatozoa fertilizing one ovum. And that usually leads to what you call a molar pregnancy. So you see these vesicles here? These are actually trophoblastic tissue, what will become the placenta. So you will have the symptoms of pregnancy, but actually there is no embryo, there is no life. It's just trophoblastic tissue with high levels of HCG, the human chorionic gonadotropin, with all the symptoms of pregnancy. So basically, it's a condition that occurs when there's an excess set of paternal chromosomes, either due to duplication of the spermatozoa or due to entry of more than one spermatozoa within the ovum. So there is abnormal vesicular proliferation of the placental tissue. So these vesicles. So it's also called a vesicular mole pregnancy. Or sometimes you can call it a hydatidiform mole. So it can either be partial or complete. The partial mole is where you have two sperms plus the ovum. So you have a triploid karyotype. So a 69XXY, a 69XXX, or a 69XYY. Okay, that will be a partial. Now, for a complete one, you actually don't have any ovum at all. So there's no ovum that forms. So you have an empty ovum with two sperms. And so that is what you call a complete mole. So thank you for listening, and if there is any question, you can leave them on the comment section below.